So Mark, tell me about templates for working with conditionals.
Sure, Rory. There are a lot of templates that can help you when creating conditional statements. So we'll start with some of the basics that I've got up here. I've got the letter B, and that will give you, inside of C#, will give you brace blocks. So if I hit letter B, followed by the template expansion key, it'll give me the opening and closing braces. You can modify that template expansion key to be either tab or spacebar, or maybe something else that makes sense to you, if that makes sense, if you want to. Mm-hmm. For me, it's just spacebar. To create an if block, I just type in if, and then I'm gonna hit the spacebar, or like I say, tab key, if that's your template expansion key. And it gives me the parens like this and the caret right in between. So it saves me a few keystrokes if I just type in if and then the spacebar, if and the template expansion key. If I type in L and the spacebar or the template expansion key, it gives me an else block. I can also chain these together. I can, for example, type in IFB, for example, to get an if block with braces. And I can also use the N to indicate a negative expression, a not. So I can type in IFN and expand that template to save me a little bit of time there if I was gonna say if not something. And if I wanna check to see if something is assigned, I can type in IFA, but I should have some sort of test variable on there and on the clipboard. If I don't have a test variable on the clipboard, it gives me this expansion right here. I'll just comment that out so you can see it. If I did have, for example, my control on the clipboard, I'll copy that to the clipboard now and I type in IFA, it gives me this. So it's basically the question is if assigned, if the value is not null. Okay.
Excellent.
That's.
So a lot of those particular templates you've been running through there have characters that you'd otherwise have to press the shift key for. And so with the particular combinations you've got there, there's no shift key. It's all pretty close, normal standard letters, and considerably easier as a result. Less keystrokes and less moving away from home keys.
Right. No shift key needed. Yeah. Right, exactly. So yeah, it's saving you some keystrokes there when you use that IFN template there.
Cool.
If I already have my if block set up, so I've got if and then some expression here, and I've got my block down here and I want to now create an else block, I can just type in, you saw L before, I could also use LB and that will give me a block. If I know in advance I'm going to have more than one line of code down inside of there, or if I always want to have braces around that, even a single line of code, I can use LB there. Okay. I can also, if I'm here, I can type in, we saw B to give me the braces. I can also type in BLB right here. And that's going to give me a brace block, an else statement, and then another brace block.
Cool. So block, so else, BLB. Block.
Exactly. Block, else, block. And then I also have LF for else if. So if I'm at this point and I wanted to have another else if, I just type in LF like that and then the space bar or the tab key to expand it. So LF. And then space or tab to expand it, whichever key you've got set up for your template expansion key,
We'll
give that to you. Okay, LF gives you else if. And then we also have the ability to give and or. And here again, we're just saving you the shift keys, plus trying to find that tiny small key that's far away from the home keys.
Sure.
So instead of having to hold down the shift key, go out and find that, pipe symbol and hit it twice, and then take your hand off the shift key, bring your fingers back to the home keys. Instead, you just type in or and then space or tab.
Nice.
Okay. Same thing over here. You just type in and space or tab.
So we default to English language and just replacing it with the symbolism that makes sense in this language, i.e. C#.
Yeah. And it's actually faster in this case, right, to type in three characters and then a space to expand them than it is to type in, to hold down the shift key, reach for that hard key to hit, right? Your cognitive load goes up as you try to find it. Hit that ampersand, hit it again now, cognitive loads up again as I release the shift key, right? And what's happening is I'm devoting more brain power to the specifics of typing the language than I am to the actual essence of whatever the expression is or solving the problem. You see what I'm saying? We're devoting, blood flow and
absolutely,
wrong parts of the brain is what's happening. And we want to keep blood flow in the creative parts of the brain. So we don't want cognitive load to go up. So that's what's going on there. And then also we have a paren embedding. Sometimes in an expression, you want to take an expression and embed it inside of parens. Like I might want to evaluate this. I want to change the evaluation on this. So instead of it being this or that and that, I want to change it to this or that and the other. So I just select that block of code and I can hit the open paren or the close paren key, either one. If I hit the close paren key, I get taken out to the right side of that. And if I undo that and hit the open paren key, I get taken to the left side. And when I say get taken, I mean the caret is over here on the left side.
Excellent. That's particularly useful, actually, as I remember in VB, where you've got various language functions whose name will go on the left-hand side. So you can deliberately choose the left paren there in order to put your caret over there, ready to type, say, cint or CSTR, which are some of the conversion functions. Very common in
VB. Yeah, or like passing it into a proc or something like that. That
absolutely.
Could be happening as well. Yep, exactly. So paren embedding is not a template, but it's a feature that's used inside of creating... creating conditional statements.
Sure.
So that's kind of my introduction to the templates that are working with conditionals. You've got the B block, B for braces. You've got just typing in if followed by the space bar or the tab key to give you this. This is why I like the space bar being my expansion key, because I don't have to do any thinking. I just type in if space and it gives me the remaining pieces that I need. L gives me the else block. IFB for an if block with braces, IFN for an if statement with a not to begin with, right, like that,
yep.
And IFA for if assigned, which kind of gives you something like this. So you, and this template, the IFA template is looking for identifiers on the clipboard. If you've got an identifier on the clipboard, it'll expand out to this. Otherwise, it'll expand out to this piece that we saw right here.
Great stuff.
So that's kind of the introduction.
That's nice. That's like one or two, maybe three at the outside characters, and you have a whole block of code that you'd otherwise have to be arrowing around and holding down shift and finding the right symbols. Just a couple of characters and you're already there.
Yeah. Next, I want to talk about it's a simple template, but it's for doing something that, you know, that we might do often. That's called create on demand or a lazy create. And so we just type in COD for create on command. I've copied control to the clipboard first. By the way, the shortcut to copy is just hit Control C or Control Insert. You don't have to select it first. So what happens if I'm on the identifier and I hit the copy key, CodeRush will select that for me. So it's a real quick copy to the clipboard, then come up and type in COD for create on demand. And then CodeRush will generate just this whole code block for you right here.
Okay, so looking at that quickly, Mark, CodeRush has detected that the variable you're on, the word control, was of type myControl. And has gone away and made an if this current instance is set to null, then I'm going to instance a new my control and assign that.
Right. And it puts the caret right there, ready to pass any parameters to it if you need to do that.
Sure.
When the expansion's done. Yeah, I'm so glad you're here, because I would have probably not have mentioned that, that it actually is smart enough to go out there and see that, right? So you can create templates like this one to do very intelligent things based on just having control to the clipboard like I just did.
Sure.
Right? Okay. All right. I want to show you some primitives next. These are not specifically exclusively used only for conditional statements and expressions inside of conditional statements, but they're used for a lot of them. And so I thought it would be good to talk about these. I've got T for true, F for false, N for null. Quote goes to double quote, single quote goes to double single quote. And then I also have some common numbers here, 1, negative 1, and 0.
Okay.
And at first you might be looking at this and thinking, well, I can see why you might want to map T for true and F for false, because that could save me some keystrokes. But you're mapping 1 to 1 and 0 to 0 and negative 1 to negative 1. Why are you doing that?
Sure, yeah.
And I'll explain that in a little bit.
Okay.
For before I get to there, let's just talk about how we can use those primitives. Now, I've got a note here, a comment that says out of scope slightly. So we're going to talk about returning values.
Mm-hmm.
And returning values is slightly out of scope because we're really talking about templates for building conditionals. But one of the things conditionals can do is you can return out of a block of code. And that's often a frequent thing, is that you use a conditional for a guard clause and you return out or exit out of the method or return a value, something like that. So just to show you to use these, I can combine the letter R. If I just hit R in the space bar, it'll give me return like that. And the caret's out here after the semicolon. But if I type in R plus one of these primitives, like RT, for example, I'll get return true. If I type in RF, I'll get return false.
Very nice.
RN will give me return null, that sort of thing.
Wow, they must get used a lot.
Yes, I use those a lot. I do. And now here's where it gets back into scope. So I've got this block here, if test and do something. Let's say otherwise I want to return false. So I'll type in LRF, else return false. And that gives me the else block, the return statement. I might type in LRT, else return true, LRN, else return null. That's where we get kind of back in, right? We've got these L combo templates. We're just basically, we're saying else return, and then what the value is you want. SE should give me else return string.empty. Okay?
Good stuff.
I'm going to just slightly go out of scope just one more to show you. You may have noticed I'm in a void proc, and I've got a return result right here.
Sure, yeah.
CodeRush refactoring. I'm sure we'll have our own video on it, but you can convert that to a function instantly if you need to. So as a result, sometimes I often just create void procs to begin with, and then I set my return value, and I let CodeRush figure out what the type is of the return.
Sure, yeah.
Okay, so we learned a little bit about returning values. We learned a little bit about the primitives. Oh, I'll answer that question of why do we have a one-to-one mapping here? Well, let's say I want to return zero. I just type in R0, and that's it. I'm done. I'm carrots at the end of the line. Otherwise, if I wanted to do it without that mapping, I'd have to type in R, move the caret over, space bar, hit the zero, move the caret out again.
Yeah.
So there's extras. So I'm actually able to save, even though this gives me no savings right here, I'm actually able to get savings in templates that use those. Does that make sense? I'm saving myself some keystrokes. And it's also nice to be thinking about it just like everything else. I want to return true, I just think in RT. I want to return zero, I just type in R0. Right? It's nice to be able to think about those like that. All right, if null return is the next block. And this works with pieces that are on the clipboard. So I'll copy, my control is to copy to the clipboard, and I'm just gonna type in INR, if null then return. And it just pastes that in, it's got it as a field, I can hit enter to get outside, and I'm done with that code right there, if null return, okay? I can also say if null then return, if null, then return true, like that. And notice, by the way, the template is not IFNR, it's just INR.
Okay.
Like that. And we're doing this because it's a way to save another keystroke, right? We're saving more keystrokes. This is something that, for me, I use this particular template all the time. I'm frequently setting up contracts in my methods, and I'm checking to see if things are good, right or not. By the way, if you do that frequently, there's also the CodeRush add contract code provider as well. So you can use that. But often I've got something on the clipboard. I want just a real quick INR like that. I'm out and I'm done and I'm ready to go on to my next line of code.
Sure.
Okay. So that's there. And then also I can specify if null, then return, and then some primitive like SE for string.empty or if null, then return null, something like that.
So all of the primitives that we had in the previous section.
They all work.
Excellent.
Yeah, in fact, it's right. You can kind of see it here. INR plus a primitive shortcut returns, basically gives you this code right here. Without that then here in C sharp. Right? If then,
okay.
If that's null, then return primitive value. Okay?
Sure.
Also, we're going to veer out of scope ever so slightly here. We're going to talk a little bit about using the letter S to set values and the letter N. And so S will set values, but it also tests to see if a value is set to something. So that's the letter S for setting values or checking to see if a value is set to something. So the slightly out of scope part is the setting values, which I'll show you at first. So I'll just copy this to clipboard test, and I'll type in SF to set to false, ST to set to true, SN to set to null, something like that.
Sure.
Okay. Grab counter, copy to the clipboard, type in S0, set to zero, S1, like that. S-1, like that.
Nice.
Okay. And copy it to the name, copy to the clipboard, come down here and we'll type in SN, set to null, SSE, set to string empty. Okay?
Yeah.
So it's very quick to make those particular changes. Looks like, do I have name in here showing up twice? I do. I'll change that right there. Okay. So that's setting values, slightly out of scope. However, these exact same templates, if used inside an if expression, if I have what I have on the clipboard, name is on the clipboard, SSE, gives me that.
Ah, So CodeRush is figuring out that we're inside the if and applying a different operator, the equivalency, the comparison.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. It's the same template, right? I can type in SN to set it to null, and now I'm checking to see if the name is null. I just went to the end of the line. I hit B, went to the beginning of the next line. I hit B space.
Sure.
And got myself those brace blocks right there. I can use is null or empty on that. And we just created a new template. It's not going to be in, it's going to come out in the next version of CodeRush. What do we did create for is null or empty? I think it's like INE or something.
SNE
now all of a sudden. SNE, yeah, string null or empty. That's what it is.
There we go. So that's a lot of typing. You just replace with four keystrokes.
Yeah, SNE for string null or empty. Okay, is null or empty. So you can do that too if you want to. But the S templates are for setting values. So again, like I can come in here, grab counter, put it to the clipboard, type in like S0, that, and now I've got counter space double equals space zero, right? Really nice use of the S for checking to see if a value is set to something.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. We've got the N, which is essentially the opposite of that. In fact, I've got a little table down here which talks about this. The template, here's the S one. We already talked about that, sure, what it does. And the expansion inside of an expression looks like that. And you can try it on an empty line, which it changes to an assignment statement, or inside an expression, when it changes to test something. And then we have the other side, which is essentially the opposite. And the difference between the two is, instead of getting a double equals, you get a not equals.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that's essentially the difference. This one is only used in expressions. This is not used because you can't do an assignment to using not equals, right?
True.
So this is never used as a statement. This is only used in expressions. And as a result, it's also got a little extra level of intelligence inside here, which we can see that right here. So I'll go copy name two on the clipboard, and we'll see that. We'll expand it out right here. So I'll just uncomment this block of code, and we'll come down here, and we'll say right here, we'll say NN for not null.
Okay.
And then we'll come down here, we'll type in NN again, and look what happened.
That's clever. There.
Right, so I'll do that again just in slow motion. We're using the exact same template right here.
Okay, so in this first if statement, we have no conditional present as yet, and we're still going to use the NN. We have name two on the clipboard.
Okay. Right, so it gives me that.
Let's put name two. It's retrieved that from the clipboard, and it says not equal to null, exactly as you expect. But
yeah,
in this next conditional, we already have name two written down there.
So... yeah, or maybe I'll just type it in, right? Let's say you type it in, you come over, and you remember, oh, wait, the NN template, Mark showed me that. So I'll just type it in now, and it still works.
But it doesn't duplicate. It's clever.
Yes, it doesn't duplicate because it sees that you've got something off to the left.
Okay.
Right? It doesn't have to be name two. It can be anything, right? You can type in anything here and then type in NT for not true, or N0 for not zero, NSE for not string empty, NN for not null.
Well, because it's more logical that you'd be expanding the thing that you've got right in front of you than it would maybe from taking it from the clipboard.
Well, yeah, and it doesn't make sense to put this next to that, right? Now, all of a sudden, we have code that doesn't make sense.
Absolutely, yeah.
So it only uses what's on the clipboard if what's on the clipboard looks like an identifier, and there's nothing else here. You're just inside empty parens.
Okay.
Like that'll give you this. Otherwise, if you're here and you do it, it gives you that.
Great stuff.
Okay. All right, and there's the SNE for string is null or empty. That's going to be in an upcoming update. You may already have it. If you don't, then you just need to get updated templates. You can contact support at devexpress.com to get updated templates if SNE is not expanding out to string.isNull or empty. Okay, got that? Ready to move on?
Let's go.
Any questions? Okay, so that just to review, we just learned about the S and the N set of templates. Okay, and they both take a primitive, are followed by a primitive shortcut. So we've seen some of this already. I'm going to copy my control to the clipboard. I'm going to type in IFA to see if it's assigned. And I can type in IFNA like this, mm-hmm, right? If not assigned, which is also similar to the if null, then return, the INR that we saw earlier, right? Where this actually gives me a return. I can just simply say IFNA, if not assigned. Okay.
Okay.
And then we've also seen NN and SN already, but I'll just show those one more time. So I'll come in here and I'll type in SN. That checks gives me, so if I know I'm at, if I'm at the if statement, or maybe I'm on a while loop, I could also be in a while loop, that sort of thing like that. Mm-hmm. And I'm here and I want to check to see if my control is null, and I know that I've got my control on the clipboard, I can just type in SN.
Cool. Like that.
By the way, if I've, you know, sometimes you, you know, as you're learning this, you forget. So you type in my control and you're out here and you're thinking, you know, oh, what can I do? I can just also hit equals N here like this, if you remember this point. And that will expand in C-sharp from one single equals to a double equals and a null. So equals null, equals T for equals true, equals zero, any of those primitives.
Okay.
And you can add to those primitives. If there are others that you want to add, you can add to those. So that's also pretty cool.
Nice.
And we saw the NNs already. So that helps you check for valid assignments. Next, I want to show you some Boolean properties. So what we've done is we've taken some Boolean properties that are relatively common in the .NET framework, and we've created some variables for them, for some shortcuts for them. C for checked, E for enabled, V for visible, SR for sorted. And now I'm going to show you the templates that start with the letter I. So if I have my control on the clipboard, I is referring to the identifier in the clipboard, I can type in I followed by one of these property variables like IC to get to see if it is checked, for example. I can type in IE to see if it's enabled, IV to see if it's visible. So it just gives you very quick access to some of those properties.
Sure.
I can also use those, by the way, so slightly off track, but I can use these with the S templates. I can type set visible to true like this, and if it's on the clipboard, it'll give me that. That's slightly out of scope here, so I won't do that so much here. But if I'm up here and I type in SVT, it checks to see if visible, set visible is true, as an example.
Very nice.
Which in an if statement doesn't make so much sense, because that would just be, you might as well just say, you might as well just take that whole thing and simplify that expression like this, right?
Sure, yeah.
But it does give you access to that kind of thing. You can also just do SV for set visible, and you can get to this point, you might compare with another variable,
mm-hmm.
like that. And that might actually make more sense. So that was just SV, SC would do that. And it's just saving you the time of getting this piece right here. Checking to see if the value is set to something, right? So the I's plus the Boolean props inside of here, like I think I showed those already. My control's on the clipboard, ISR, all of those things, you can very quickly get access to those. Okay?
All right, yep.
Let's go ahead and make this code legal. So at least compiles, and then let's go down here, integer properties. So there's some integer properties, some numeric properties, and I just have those shortcuts listed right here. Left is LT, length is LN, and width is WD, height is HT, CN is count, and some other properties too. NM is name, TX is text, and other common properties that are not string or integer or bools. You've got client rectangle, PA for parent, and SZ for size. And so now what I can do is if I've got my control copied to the clipboard, I'm inside here, I can access any of these property shortcuts again using the letter I. So I can type in like IWD to grab its width, IHT to grab its height. Right. So that I is like the identifier. Just paste that in there for you.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay.
I was just wondering, Mark, what happens if the object in question doesn't have a height?
Okay, that's a great question. So my control, let's dive into that. Let's go grab height, and we will comment that out. We'll jump back, and we'll type in IHT in the space bar, and it expands it. But I'm thinking it just because the parser hasn't caught up yet with our change. And my expectation is that it actually is not going to do that. Yeah, there we go. So it was the background parser not cut up to our change yet because it happened outside in the other file, and I made a change to one line without leaving and hitting enter on the line.
But if this had been some other class that didn't have the height to start with, where we hadn't had to edit it to take it out, we would have just seen the same kind of theory. So we're not overriding in that case.
Right. The other thing is the background parser. This is kind of behind the scenes in how CodeRush works, but the background parser is waiting for you to commit the line by hitting enter on the line or something along those lines. And I just came in here and I just commented out very quickly and I moved over. I didn't even save the file like I just did there. And I came back over and tried to use it. So the background parser is like, okay, that's a lower priority. And it took a moment before it finally caught up. So now that's what's going to happen. You're just going to get IHT if it doesn't exist. So IWD still works and IHT doesn't.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Also with the set plus the property shortcut. So I might want to check to see, I might type in like SWD like this, and then I can compare it against some value, like whatever that's going to be. Okay. So inside the expression, SLT, see what the left value is, that sort of thing. Okay. So those S templates, check to see if the value is set. You can use those with the property shortcut. SCR is going to give me, check the client rectangle. Again, it's got to have these properties for the templates to work. If they don't, the templates won't work. The templates are checking to see if the piece on the clipboard has a property called parent or size or right or width. Okay?
Right.
And again, you can extend all of these. You can add your own shortcuts for your own common properties that you work with a lot. You find yourself typing in similar kinds of property names again and again, you can make that a lot faster.
Nice.
One other thing with this, I've got here a comment here that says if it's an int prop optionally followed by a 0, 1, or a negative 1. So for example, if I come in here and I've got an int prop like left, let's see, is my control cell on the clipboard? It is. I can type in SLT0, like that. Or SLT1, or is count, let's do it with count. SCN for count, 0, if count is equal to 0. Okay.
That's good. So all the little pieces we've been picking up as we've gone along, they basically all work with all of the other pieces that you'd expect them to.
Kind of all of the other pieces. It's kind of is the answer to that question. Yeah. There are some limitations from that you can hit against in the template engine, but they're kind of advanced edge case limitations. But the answer is yes, it's kind of like that is the answer to the question. And that's my last example that I have is just checking other properties. So that's it.
Well, thank you very much, Mark. That's been very useful.